the clock on the wall, which is what we go by. So if I can welcome you all to today's Merseytravel Committee meeting. First item is apologies for that.
Councillor Shields?
I believe everyone else looks like we're in the seat, so yeah, if that's acknowledged. Second item is obviously the usual declarations of interest, and that's just a reminder from me that either if there's anything you're aware of now or anything that crops up during the proceedings of the meetings that you think you need to declare, please don't hesitate to do so. Third item is the minutes of the last meeting. There's just one correction that I was spotted with regard to that in the page number four, as it says in the final paragraph, that I also praised FIRST for their significant transformation of the bus network following the development of intercity services. That should be franchise, as we know, the FIRST group left the city region in terms of bus services a few years ago. So that's the only kind of correction I've spotted. Other than that, are there any other kind of elements anyone wants to raise, or can you agree those minutes is a correct record of what happened way very well on the 2nd of March? That's agreed though. Thank you. Okay, moving on to the probably what I expect to be the most substantive item this afternoon. Obviously, we like to invite our operator colleagues periodically to come and present to the committee to tell us what they've been doing, what progress they've made, and what plans we've got in the pipeline. So it's a great pleasure that we're welcoming Howard Farrall as Managing Director of Arriva's bus operations right across Merseyside to give a presentation on behalf of Arriva, and then obviously we'll have the opportunity to ask some questions, have a bit of a debate, discussion, and take it from there. So Howard, welcome. Over to you.
Thank you, Liam. Good afternoon, ladies and gents. Thanks very much for the invite back again. I haven't mentioned the Alliance because I know very conscious that Matt's going to do that later, so I'm just going to give you a little bit of an update where the Arriva is, where it's going, some of the things that we've been doing over the last 6 to 12 months, also hopefully a little bit about sort of what's going to happen in the future. So just a little bit of background. We have grown over the last number of years. We now employ more than 60,000 people, 2.2 billion passenger journeys, and we operate now in 14 European countries. A couple of years ago, I would have said that the UK bus was probably a bit part of Arriva, but I think when you see the slides you're about to see, you can see how much it's grown in Europe as well as in the UK as well. I think one of the things that always interests people is we don't just do bus. So we operate trains, because you know about the franchise of Arriva Rail Northern. But we also do water bus, trams, metros, cars and ambulance. So quite a varied operation all over Europe, but it isn't just buses. That gives you a little bit of a highlight. We operate in 14 countries. Certainly over the last 3 or 4 years, most of them have been on the Eastern Bloc, but we're growing all the time. And as you can see, the UK is still the largest, so we've got just short of 30,000 employees in the UK, with just short of 5,500 buses. We are 23% of the market in London, which, as you know, is a franchised operation. We operate in southern counties, Midlands and Shires, northwestern Wales, and northeast and Yorkshire. So that's a little bit about us. We're the northwestern Wales. I look after Merseyside. There's a fellow MD that looks after Manchester, and there's a fellow MD that looks after Wales. We turn over about £163 million, just over 1,000 buses, 2,500 drivers. It's made up of supervisors, managers, cleaners, from 14 garages. And this is a little bit about Merseyside and what we've been doing in the last 6 to 12 months. So that's my area, that's carriages go from Southport in the north, Bootle, St Helens, Green Lane, Speak and Birkenhead. Turnover about £110 million. We employ just over 2,000 employees, fleet of 660 vehicles, and we carry 74 million passengers a year. And I think the interesting thing is if you add that to stagecoach numbers, we probably carry three times more than the rail. So it's quite a significant large amount of people that we carry. So what have we been up to? Well, you'll probably recognise the vehicle that's on there, because we've just taken delivery of 51 hybrids. They initially went on the rail replacement that we were looking up to secure between Birkenhead and Liverpool, which took an awful lot of organising. But as well as that, there are a lot of other events that we get involved with right throughout the year. And that just gives you the flavour of what we do during the 12 months. It isn't just about operating buses, we're also a big part of a lot of these events that go on in and around the city region. But I have to say that the slab track was probably the biggest one, the biggest contract that we've done probably for the last 50 years. We had something like 80 drivers dedicated to it, at one point 40 vehicles every day. There was a lot of planning, there was a lot of ad hoc stuff that went on. We had a great partnership with British Transport Police, Merseytravel. The control group was actually based here on the second floor. And there was an awful lot of organisation that went into operating this lab track. And hopefully people have found it very useful. And I'll just give you some stats a little bit later that might be of interest to you. Some of the things that we had to think about was what would happen if the weather was bad, if we had a bad dose of snow. So again, we were looking at that, breakdowns, we could have breakdowns in the tunnel. So we had to really think about what contingencies we had in place, just in case if there was any emergencies during the slab track, just for that 6 weeks. There are other things that affected as well. There was also the football games, weekends. It wasn't just about sort of what was going on with workers and shoppers, there was also all sorts of events that were going on in and around. So again, that had to be mapped out and planned. That was the support mechanism that we put in place, and obviously that was led by myself, but I have to say it was mainly Barry Dobson on the ground that organised it, and he was literally based here for the 6 weeks of the operation. We had a dedicated team, supervisors, and what we did is we put them in the same place every day, at least so they could get to know the people. We gave them different colour high vises, so they stood out, at least when passengers got off the train and onto the bus, they were able to recognise our staff straight away and then ushered them on to the rail replacement vehicles. And that worked really well with loading, because some of the loadings off the trains at certain times of the day were extremely busy. Like I said to you before, there was just short of 80 drivers. Every driver went through a 7-hour training pack. Every driver had an induction through the tunnel, because you'll appreciate that some of these drivers came from other garages and probably hadn't driven the bus through the tunnel. So it was important that they were in the right lane, because otherwise that would give me a lot of sleepless nights. So they all went through dedicated training, and hopefully that's paid off. We also had to get all the vehicles into the garage at Cllr Street. That was another 40 vehicles onto our site. Was quite a challenge, because obviously there's fuel and cleaning, and then there's parking. So we had an aerial photograph done to make sure that we could get all the vehicles in, but also get them out in the morning on time. We agreed with the tunnel police that in cases of emergency or in case of travel disruption, that they could use the back way into the tunnel, so the rail replacement didn't have to go through the booths. And we only had to use that three times during the 6 weeks, so I think that was very well controlled. Other things that were of interest were some of the road conditions weren't very good. Potholes on one of the routes. What we couldn't have, or tunnels were done, and that was a great benefit to us. So I think all in all it was a great team effort. It was a lot of work that went into it. It was almost 12 months of planning, to be fair. The new vehicles certainly helped. We increased our own cross-river services, and at the moment they are still at the high frequency of every 7 and 8. The feedback we had has been very positive. We've kept 30% of those extra passengers that we had when the rail was on there, so that might be to the detriment of the rail, but I'm very pleased to say that we've stayed with us on the bus. And I think some of the things that I've really hit home have been things like free Wi-Fi, leather seats, USB charging, have all made a massive difference. And the long-term plan is that we can continue to grow those services. So all in all, a lot of investment, $23 million in 2017. The first 51 hybrids have arrived. The next buses to come are the 9 gas buses for Runcorn. They go into service sometime towards July. And then the other big one, which will be a big event, there are 12 fully electric vehicles being delivered to Green Lane. They will go into service on the 26th and 27th from probably the third week in September. And again, that's another big investment of about £3.5 million. And we are hoping to get the Secretary of State to come down and cut the ribbon on that, because it is one of the, obviously it's the first fully electric vehicles that Arriva's been part of. So again, something to look forward to later on in the year. So what else have we done? Obviously the Destination Green is all about, a lot of it is about air pollution. You've probably read that there are 5 cities that have been picked to look at air pollution. There are another 20 on the list. I'm guessing Liverpool is going to be one of them. So again, it's important that as far as Arriva is concerned, continue to invest in these vehicles and the electric vehicles, and hopefully we can reduce the emissions in and around the city centre and the region. A lot of the stuff we've done with the communities, probably we don't shout about, but perhaps we should do, and I'll just give you a few examples. So you've got the arts and music, you've got the Reader Foundation. I won't read them all, I'll just leave them up there. There's an awful lot that we do about the CSR, about getting involved. It's a bit small, sorry. Just so much on there, really. So a couple of examples with Tramia Rovers. We're converting a single decker into a soup kitchen. So we're going around to the homeless, and our drivers will be doing it. They're all volunteers to give out food and drink. We're doing that with Tramia. We're looking at Liverpool One. We're looking to go into there. We've got a new business manager who is going to go into all the local businesses and try and encourage people to buy travel plans, weekly tickets at reduced rates. So that's another idea that we're doing. And the speak schools, we do a lot in the south of Liverpool with regards to the schools in speak, regards to sponsoring football events that they do. So it's quite a big list. Some of the things that we've done this year, the buses on the left-hand side were from the Liverpool Biannual. They managed to cope me. Originally it was one, but it actually turned out to be 3. The middle one, the pink one, was designed by the children at Netherley School. They actually designed it and did it. They went to our body shop in St. Helens. They saw the bus being painted from start to the end. They had an involvement in it. And it's the only bus I can think of that the kids are very protective of, so there's never any vandalism or damage on that particular bus, but it sort of went down like a real school. The one below is self-explanatory, that was about to come to birthday, and you'll have seen probably the Zoe's Place bus that goes around as well. So there are a number of other things that we do with regards to marketing. And some of the other stuff that we're doing with the Everyman Theatre and the Reader Foundation. And again, it's about trying to get people on, apprentices, young people That opens on the 9th of June this year, where we'll be doing our own apprenticeship scheme. We've currently got 21 apprentices, there they are on the right hand side, with another 5 starting in September. And we hope that that training academy is going to be something that we can build on later on, and it might be something that other people are able to use rather than sending people away and to keep them local. We've got 2 grads, and we take 2 on normally every year. It's going to be a marketing grad and a general manager sort of graduate, so we do a lot of other schemes. We're in the process of making sure that every single driver, all 2,000, are sent on the Merseytravel customer service training, which is part of the Alliance. We will be a third of the way through this year, and we'll do the second lot in year 2, the third in year 3. That's gone down really well because it's interactive, and again, it just gives us a little bit more emphasis on the customer and how important they are, not only to us, but to the drivers as well. We've got the National Man Awards, so every time somebody puts forward a good idea or does something, we nominate them for a Man Award. We've won 3 so far in the Northwest area, that's right throughout the country. So again, that's something that we're very proud of. And the final one is about the Long Service Awards. We have these every year. We've got 4 staff currently that have done just over 50 years. So we've made a special fuss out of them, and we normally have about just over 220 attend the evening every year that have done either 25, 30, 35, 40, 45 years. So again, it's a bit like the rail industry, you're either here for 12 months, if you're not here, if you can last after 12 months, you're normally here for about 40 years. So if it does get into your blood, it does stick, but it's very important for us that we recognise our staff. We reward long service because it's very, very important to us. So then just a few things that we're doing about the people update. I think the final slide that I've got is about, just one more. Very recently, you'll know this from Transport Foulkes, and again, I don't want to steal Matt's thunder, but we have done extremely well. We are one of the leading authorities, but also, as far as the customer service is concerned, we are one of the leading companies in the UK. So Arriva Northwest has 3 in the top 10, which is exceptional. Our employee surveys tell us that over 80% of our staff are more than satisfied with their job, which is, again, in any industry, I think the benchmark is about between 55% and 60%. So again, it's a really good result. I'd like to think that everyone is happy working for Arriva, but I've no doubt you'll get a minority in every organisation. And again, it's all about the customer. Again, one of the questions was, understand what I can do to help deliver excellent service to our customers. 90% responded favourably. So again, that's been a long-term aim. We've been trying to change the culture over the years to make sure that our staff are aware that what's important is what we deliver to our customers. And that's about investment in vehicles, investment in our staff, investment in our equipment, investment in our properties as well. So it just follows on all the way along. And for those of you who may not have seen them, this is our new brand. The colours are slightly changing, it's a bit more brighter. The greens won't change from the hybrids because they are a specific brand. But any ordinary new buses, Euro 6 that come in, will have this new brand. So if you do see it flying around at the moment, that's what it's about. It just made it a little bit brighter, and also I think they just wanted to refresh the brand a little bit. So if you do see them around, that's what it's about.
Thanks for that, Howard. I think that was really sort of useful just to kind of whet everyone's appetite. I'm sure there'll be lots of people with lots of questions, but I'm already seeing lots of hands going up. Before I just open up to the questions, I think it's probably useful for me just to say, when you last came to see us, you were still on your feet, quite a while, I think it's fair to say you got a pretty good grip, but quite positively, I went back and revisited the minutes of that committee meeting and sort of looked at all the different things that we asked. And absolutely, I thought it was a really positive session, because a number of things that we asked, for example, about tackling the price differential between different parts of Merseyside, for example, where St Helens had a different fare structure to Liverpool, which had a different one to Wirral. Tackling the cost of young people to travel, because it used to be two-thirds in terms of young persons' fares, and also things like the age validity for young people, it used to be 16. Why I think it's really positive, because all those issues were aired, and within a few months, it's solved, unfortunately. So I'm hopeful that there's going to be a number of questions going to be asked now, that within a few months, you'll be able to give us some very positive news on. So no pressure on that point, Howard. But if I could see those hands again, I'll start with Ron, and I'll just keep them up so I can write everyone down. Steps are going to be as an organisation going forward to support growth in the future.
I think the first, the last 2 years have been a great success. There's no doubt that the growth has come from the child. The child tickets, there's absolutely no doubt about that. And we've done it in the last 2 years without a marketing strategy. So I think that there's still a lot to go at as far as the Alliance is concerned. I think once we can market the successes that we've had with the investment, with the current investment, and any investment going forward, yes, I understand there's a balance between fares. I know it's always a hot topic whenever you talk about fares, but there has to be a balance at the end of the day. We are still a business. We still have to make a profit. It's that profit that allows the investment account to continue, and we're also very conscious of the fact that I've no doubt the targets that are going to be set in the Alliance next week are going to be quite challenging, but I do believe that there is no reason why we can't go from strength to strength with some of the plans that we've got in place. I've got no doubt about that. Franchising doesn't worry me. We have a deal, we have a 5-year deal. It's up to us to prove that it works. If it doesn't work, then I can't argue it. If we deliver the results we say we're going to deliver, well then that's all we can do. It may be taken out of our hands, and so be it. We operate in a franchise market in London. It's not something that we're afraid of. It's not something that we would want, because we believe partnerships are better and they can deliver it a lot better. But it's not something tried it over here. An act, so I'll explain a little bit about the growth in the child tickets. So when we increased the age from 16 to under 19, 18 year olds, 16 to 18, there was a huge growth. It was a massive growth, about 80% for us, for what was for Stagecoach, but it's massive, and 80% sounds fantastic, but the discount was 120%. So yes, there was a great discount for people before paying £4.30 a day ticket. Now they're only paying £2. So you can imagine that there's a massive discount on that ticket, and you need a lot more than 80% in order to break even. So yes, we certainly did it for the kids under 19s, but again, there's a balancing act between what we have to do to continue to drive revenue, because our costs will go up. Right, fuel's fixed for us for 3 years, so it goes up and down, doesn't matter, it's hedged for us. But again, there's labour costs. People want, you know, labour is probably 55% of all our costs, so it's, you know, we have to balance that off against what we do with our some revenue and our investment. And you know, I can tell you that we've spent probably 70 million in the last 3 years on new vehicles. You show me another bus industry that's done that in the country, never mind here, apart from London.
You
never happy. Sorry.
I think the term we use, Howard, is we're proud but we're never satisfied.
Correct.
So
never spend on the long.
Yeah, if I've got Jerry next, then Steve, then Gordon, then Jeremy, then Mary, then Gillian, then Harry, and Ken. We're missing one. And John and Natalie as well. So, Jerry, you go next.
Yeah, well, I still appreciate the fares consolidation that we introduced across Merseyside. We've got to see the winter applications. We've been some pounds at the
many of the lights go behind us.
Right, sorry, my apologies. You want me to start again?
No.
Many local people still raise the issue of short journeys being very expensive, the £2.20 flat fare. Would you look to introduce